Blog Talk Radio.
Paranormal Geeks Radio. It is March 18th, 2014, the year of our Lord. I want to welcome you all to Paranormal Geeks Radio. I'm your host, Jim Heater. We have a two-segment show tonight, and I am going to not talk about anything that's really paranormal going on here in Illinois or anything that I'm going to be doing, any UFO things or anything or ghost things. We are going to just get right to the show since we only have an hour with each guest. I never thought saying those three words together would be tough, but I guess apparently it is. Well, our first guest is living in Phoenix, Arizona. She is the director of MVD Ghostchasers of Mesa and Bisbee, Arizona, paranormal team. And that paranormal team has been operating since 1994. She is also a author of let's see, Sleeping with Ghosts, A Ghost Hunter's Guide to Arizona's Haunted Hotels and Inns, and Grand Canyon Ghost Stories. And she also has a couple children's books under her belt. She's also a public speaker at junior colleges and colleges around Arizona. And she was also on an episode of Travel Channel's Ghost Stories about haunted Jerome, Arizona. And this was back in July of 2010. So what we're going to do now is bring tonight's guest on. And welcome Debe Branning. How are you doing tonight?
I'm doing great. How are you doing?
I'm living the dream. Or a dream.
Yeah, a dream. A nightmare.
It all depends. Today, well, I'll tell you what, I've turned over a new leaf. I am not accepting anything negative in my life. Things are finally starting to go my way. With both here in Illinois, and also things are looking good out there in Arizona, where I hope to be living within the next 5 or 6 months. So, you know, I'm trying to keep my chin up. I say not thinking anything negative, and I'm moving on.
It's amazing how good that works. Yeah, it's amazing how good that works when you keep that positive attitude and keep the negative away. Everything starts going in the right path.
Exactly. I'm here for just a couple months, things that I've made some commitments to. One of them, or there's a couple things that have to do with cemetery restoration. I just started doing cemetery restoration. I got on a little team here in Illinois that we find small cemeteries that need some work, and we go in and turn in all the paperwork to the state and go in and, you know, reset stones and clean stones, but you also have to go through some state classes before you can do that. Now, this is something also that you do out there in Arizona. Is that correct?
Yep, that's what we do. I'm on the board of directors at the Pioneer Cemetery in downtown Phoenix. It's the cemetery where all the first residents in Phoenix were buried. And I've been with them about 10, 12 years now. And we're doing a lot of fundraisers to get a restoration team down here to do all the big stuff. I mean, the heavy-duty things that need the professionals to work on. We're working on all the little small-time, you know, things like, re-stabilizing and cleaning and that type. But sometimes you need the big guys to come in and do that heavy-duty stuff. So we've been doing fundraisers for about the last 3 or 4 years. Our big event now is in the fall. We do Dining Among the Dead, where we actually have a big Victorian dinner party in our big patio right in the middle of the cemetery. So it's really kind of a really neat ambiance, you know, late at night when we light up all the luminaries and we do a tour with characters, and we have an actor come and do a play, and then we have a full-course meal going and sell lots of raffle tickets during the event, and little by little we're getting there. But it's really a fun event. It's really a fun event. Yeah, if you're out here by the fall, you'll have to come up and do this for sure.
Don't you also have something coming up here in April?
Actually, this weekend we have our historic walk in the cemetery, which is a daytime historic walk. We have 8 characters out in the cemetery. We're doing the lawmen this time. We're doing various sheriffs and police and deputies that were in early Phoenix and Arizona area, and some of them are played by gentlemen playing the sheriffs, and some of them are their wives telling the stories of their husbands. And it's only $10 a person for adults, and $5 for kids under 12, and kids under 5 are free. And we're doing root beer floats for $2 at the end of the walk. So when you finish getting all hot and bothered walking around for an hour, you come back and you can get a nice root beer float to cool you down. So that's coming up this Saturday. And then next, in April, we're doing the annual cemetery crawls, amazing cemetery crawl. I always wanted to be on the Amazing Race, and since I couldn't be on there, we decided we would do a cemetery crawl, which is much like it. We go from 2 days all around the state. We take different paths every year. And while they're out looking for cemeteries, they're doing all kinds of crazy tasks. Seeing all those little historic monuments you always pass by when you're on the highway because you don't want to bother to stop.
Yeah.
Well, during the cemetery crawl, you have to stop and take pictures with them, and we give them little tasks and weird games to play along the way, and it gets to be just like Amazing Race. But the second day, you know, they decide they're really going to get competitive, and, you know, there's fighting in the cars because they all videotape in their cars. That's really fun. And it's just a blast, you know, because you get to see parts of Arizona you don't normally bother. We've done it in 125-degree weather. We've done it in snow. We've done it in rain. It's always something people look forward to every year. It's a lot of work.
Is this something you do every year?
Yeah,
we do.
This is the ninth time we've done it, and it's always just been really a blast. Like I said, crazy things happen. I mean, we've actually seen ghosts in the cemeteries in the daytime on this run a few times. So you never know what's going to happen. Yeah.
Excellent. Well, I know what I'm going to be doing next April.
You get your team of three people. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm sure I can round those up. With the different things, like, people are going to stop by the thing.
No, we're not going in that direction, but I can't tell you which way we're going because it's a secret. Some of the participants might be listening in. The only thing they know is where they're going to be sleeping that night. And this year, they know they're going to be sleeping in Kingman. And that's all they know.
Wow.
They have no clue how they're going to get there and what they're going to do along the way. Yeah, it's like a secret path.
Well,
and then at the end, they win a fabulous bag of crap. they just win little silly prizes and, you know, things people give me, you know, that are ghostly related. We throw in the bags and, you know, so I always tell them, they're like, you know, don't get too crazy out there and get speeding tickets and accidents because you're not winning $1,000, you're not winning $100, you're winning a bag of crap. It's a prestige, though. Some of these teams have been playing 6-7 years, so they're like, you know, they want to win. They want to keep up on, you know, being the top dog. But we have a lot of new teams this year, so it's going to be fun. I always like when there's a new bunch because they have no clue what they're in for until they get out there on the road. And then they're like, oh, my God. Most of them come back. We have one team that they're actually quite elderly, and I mean they were they had so much fun, but one of them is having surgery, so they're just going to be helpers this year. So it's fun. It's
cool.
Really a lot of fun. Yeah,
that's excellent. Now you also have a couple, well, one paranormal team, but they're in two different cities. I do this. I have the same thing. I have one here in Champaign, and I have another one up in Chicago. You tell us a little bit about your Ghost Chasers team?
Yeah, the main group's up here in the Phoenix area, and like I said, we've been together for almost 20 years now, and it grows and it gets big. The team, you know, it have a lot of new people, and then it goes, you know, shrinks back down. We still have probably 5 or 6 core people that do most of the ghost hunting and investigations, and the team down in Bisbee is just a few friends that live down there, so when we go down that way, if we have something we need to do, we grab those people. But we've traveled probably everywhere in Arizona. We like historical places, so we like to go to a lot of the old cemeteries, old hotels, old, you know, buildings where restaurants are, ghost towns, mining towns, you know, the old jails, things like that. So that's our main, you know, focus. And then with, you know, being down, Bisbee's an old mining town south, so there's a lot of old places down that way where we go. And we do a lot of that, a lot of research. That's mainly what I do all day. I just read a lot of old newspapers and find interesting things. We go, oh, got to go there. And what else? We've been to Europe 3 times, not as a team, but a lot of the members of the team. We've gone to England, Scotland, and Ireland on actual, ghost hunting tours. And so, you know, we've gotten to see a lot of the really haunted places over there. Last year we did Ireland and got to kiss the Blarney Stone. That was my favorite thing, I think. We did go to Lepp Castle and had a private tour with the owner of the castle. He was there that day and told us all the stories. And, you know, it's really not that scary of a place like they, you know, bring it on to be on TV because, you know, he likes the ghosts and they respect him. So there isn't that defiance like, you know, a lot of the stories of the Lepp Castle with the elemental and all that. I think he's calmed it down. Yeah.
After all those years.
Yeah. Well, he's been there. Yeah, he's been there for quite a while. I remember him saying that, he, you know, when he first moved in, he was working and he was up on the ladder and something knocked the ladder over and broke his leg. And then he sat down and had a chat with them saying, well, I'm not going anywhere. Get used to me being here. And after that, they kind of calmed down. And now, you know, he says, I'm just, you know, here to make the castle better, and they've accepted that. So they don't bother him anymore. It's kind of neat.
That brings up an interesting subject. When do you do many residentials, people calling you saying their house is haunted?
Not very many, because most of the time they're not. And then they get mad.
Exactly.
And so we do the ones that are friends of friends of friends of friends, you know. It just I have one set rules when I get a call in a residential. I have people keep a diary for a week or two and jot down everything that's happening and the time of day it's happening, because if it's only happening at 7 p.m. at night, I'm not going to come at 10 o'clock at night. I'm not going to come at 3 in the afternoon. I'm going to come at the time when everything's happening. So I have them keep a diary for me. And sometimes that's just way too much work for them, and then they just kind of like, okay, I'm not going to do this. Otherwise, you know, a lot of the times... And I find a lot of times residentials, when you go, it's mainly a counseling session. You know, you find out what's going on in their life. You know, basically, you pretty much debunk everything. I remember at one time I was doing a lot of work with Ghost Hunters, the TV show, you know, when they used to have their little teams around the country do investigations for them. And when people knew that, they thought that we were going to come there with the TV crew, and they, as soon as they'd find out that, no, we're just doing it in behalf of Ghost Hunters, then they'd be like, okay, well, never mind. So some of the people just, you know, want, you know, to be on TV, or they want the status that their place is haunted. So I really go through doing residential house calls, whatever you want to call them, really tightly, you know, scrutinized, because I don't like to waste my time if I can find out or counsel them, you know, ahead of time. You know, like people, you know, I've had people say, you know, they've had banging on windows and we get there, it's tree branches and, you know, that type of thing. People saying they're having bad dreams and their alarm clock, you know, is right by their face, you know, things like that. So sometimes you just have to kind of like, or the electrical box of their house is on, at, you know, the other side of the wall, their headboard. So sometimes you just have to kind of direct them a little bit, and they realize it's really not a haunt that just needs a little feng shui.
Exactly. Just moving things around, like I say, getting things away from from the pillow. And like I say, everybody has.
Right.
Oh, a lot of people have a clock radio, which gives off EMF.
Or they have their cell phone laying right next to them, you know, on the nightstand. And, you know, that puts off stuff too, so.
Yeah, receives and, like, I mean, all through the night, receives and transmits all night. So, I mean, a lot of people don't even think of that.
Right. Well, you know, we've really enjoyed working in the cemeteries, and it's kind of like we're kind of those kind of people. When you're driving on the road, you see a cemetery break, and you're out there, you know, walking around. You can learn so much from a cemetery. You know, what people died from. You know, you can.
All right.
you know, it's different
sad.
Families, and you know, and even you know, working with your own family as far as learning your own history. Cemeteries are just full of history. I'm amazed sometimes when I learn about a new person in the, you know, the cemetery in downtown Phoenix. You know, that has passed and they're buried in our cemetery. You know, we have, you know, like I said, several. Sheriffs and lawmen. One time we did, last year we did, I think, the physicians and the doctors, and I was amazed there's probably 20-some doctors buried in that cemetery. And that cemetery was only in operation from about 1884 to 1914, you know, when Phoenix was just getting started. So, you know, you just, you know, every time I go out there, I find a tombstone I've never seen before. And it's fascinating. It really is.
Yeah, it really is. How did you get involved with? We'll start off with the ghost hunting. What got you involved with the paranormal and chasing ghosts?
You know, I think it's just about, you know, everybody, same thing as everybody else out there. They had experiences as a child or a teenager, and you know, you always wondered about, you know, did this really happen? Did that really happen? And then, of course, you know, in the you know. Late 80s, early 90s, when you know Ghostbusters came out, and I just thought that was like really fascinating. So you know, our little group in the beginning, you know, we just kind of all got together after work. We all worked for the DMV. That's what MVD Ghostchasers stand for. In the beginning, we were all employees of the motor vehicle division, so it was kind of an outlet to, you know, to get away after work, and we all had the same interest. And then after that, you know, we've kind of expanded, and other people are with us now. And so it was just kind of a fun thing in the very beginning, and then we got serious, you know, like, you know, these things are really happening. And yeah. And then, of course, you know, the TV shows all came about, and that, you know, kind of made everybody wanted to be a ghost hunter. And
right.
I don't know how many people email me now and go, like, you know, if you have any openings on your team, we watch all the TV shows. We know what to do. And I'm like, okay.
Yep, you know.
And, yeah, and I'm like, all righty. And you know, we do a lot of what we call workshops. We try to do about three of them a year, and that's when we invite people that are already on paranormal teams, or you know, have a ghost buddy and they want to, you know, do something, or just people that want to learn about it. We invite everybody to come to these workshops, and generally we'll book like a hotel, and we'll do a class on something, and then we'll have, like, you know, open ghost hunting all night long in these places, and you know, we don't charge an arm and a leg like some people do. And I mean, we've had events, we've had like four or five paranormal teams all working together, and it's really a lot of fun because you learn from each other, and you know, that's, you know, kind of my goal, you know. You know, it's not as bad as it was there for a while, where everybody had their own turf, and you know, you can't go ghost hunting there because that's where we go ghost hunting, blah blah blah. And I'm like, you know, I probably went there before you even thought about being a ghost hunter. So it's like, whatever. So you know, it's fun to get the different groups together, because everybody has something they can share, or somebody has a new piece of equipment that they can demonstrate. So these workshops have been really beneficial. And, you know, a lot of times I've been doing the workshops probably for about 12, 14 years now, and I've got people that have come to these, not every time, but, you know, within the last 12 years, they've at least come once a year or every other year to a workshop. And so it's kind of cool to see these same people, after all these years, still have the interest and they still have things to share. And that's really a lot of fun. We rented one hotel, and we just had women come and had a big slumber party ghost hunt all night. And it was really great because we had, you know, women from various ghost teams, you know, bringing all their gear in and setting things up. So it was really fun. So we do that a lot. Yeah. So that's how I got into the paranormal thing. Yeah, go ahead.
You mentioned having, you know, other teams having their own turf and stuff. So that's... we aren't all about that. There's maybe a half dozen paranormal teams we like to work with up in the Chicago area, maybe two or three down south of us here in mid-south Illinois. But, and there's just not enough I mean, the ones that just get real possessive and
it's not that bad here anymore. But there was a time, you know, when I mean, you know, nobody wanted to share evidence, and you know, nobody.
Right.
You'd ask them for directions to somewhere, and they're like, oh, no, you can't go there because that's where we go, you know. So it's like, eh. That's why I started doing my column with examiner.com, actually. I've been writing for them for about 5 years. I do a column on Arizona haunted places, and I do another one, a national column haunted sites as well. And that's why I started doing it, because I thought, you know what, I'm just going to share everything I know. I don't care. And so then, things kind of calm down. And so it's not so bad. Everybody's, you know, gets along a lot better with all the teams and things now. So, and it makes it so much more fun.
Well, it's not like you're going to go to some place that someone else goes and you're going to use up all their ghosts.
I think it was
empty. I don't know.
Yeah, I think it was during the time when all the TV shows were all fresh, and everybody thought, well, you know, they were out there trying to, you know, be on TV shows, and they didn't, you know, they didn't want to share anything. And it's like, you know, now that it's kind of, you know, died down a bit, I think people are finally realizing, well, this is just something, it's more of a science, you know, we're not going to get our own TV show, so let's just all get along here and, like, have fun together, you know. So I think
exactly.
it's a lot better. Yeah.
Well, speaking of the paranormal TV shows, do you have a favorite, like that you like the way they work, like the way they think, or anything like that? So I personally don't watch them much anymore.
I watch them on and off, and I mainly watch them for the locations, you know, because they might be at a location at a place though that I really wanted to go to. So I like to see, you know, what they discover and what the place looks like, or if the place that I've already been, and I kind of like to compare what I saw when I was there. So it just depends, I think, where they're going and things. You know, I like Ghost Hunters, and I like Ghost Adventures, and I think those are the two main ones still alive out there now. I liked Ghost Hunters International as well when that was on, and Yeah, they went to some really great places. So I think I just mainly watch it just for the locations, you know, no matter which group it is. And it just depends how they, you know, what they come up with when they're at that location, whether I like that particular show or not. You know, sometimes they do it up really great, and other times I'm like, oh, that's not how that went, you know. Because you know, I'm, like I said, I'm kind of always reading the newspaper article. So if they start, you know, messing around with the facts, then I'm like writing them like, you guys, you messed that one up.
Oh, yeah.
You know, so, yeah.
That is one thing I like about these shows. They do delve into a little bit of the history of the place. Not as much sometimes I like. And I know there are a couple places or a couple teams, a couple shows that they, you know, didn't get things quite right. And that was really the talk of the internet for the next week, like you're saying.
Oh, yeah. Definitely.
That's all the buzz.
Yeah, definitely. And I watch for that, too, because, of, you know, because I... Like I said, if there's a place that I've already been and I've done the research on, and then they come and do a show on it, I'm like, oh, that's not how that went. And it makes me crazy. Then I'm like, well, should I really trust them if they can't, like, you know, do the research, you know? So I think research is the most important thing. And, you know, like I always tell everybody, the history and the mystery kind of goes hand in hand. You know, if you know the history, and that kind of maybe will even solve the mystery of what's going on there. So
when you're watching the show, you're like it really is. You don't want to get it gives you a bad name. It's something simple, that Lee Harvey Oswald shot Abraham Lincoln. Wait a minute. Whoa, whoa, whoa.
What?
Take the time, because it does. It gives you a little bit of a credibility problem. But I can see you, right. You watching these shows. You're like the continuity person in a movie to make sure that all the scenes click and there's not a garbage truck in the scene or something.
It's like watching a movie, and after you've read the book and they've changed the whole story, then you're like going, no, that's not how that goes. And
mm-hmm.
So, and I think it's just important for them to stay credible. And, and I know sometimes, some of the shows are out there for the boo factor. I've been contacted by some of the shows, asking for if I know any stories on this and this and this and this. And, some of them were, like, wanting to exploit children. Do you know any families whose children had to go through like therapy and now they're adults and they want to talk about that? I'm like, why would I want to make them go through that again?
After the thousands of dollars spent on that, you want to go?
Yeah. I know. And so I said no. I'm not gonna be a part of that. I probably do know people that have gone through trauma from ghosts as a child, but I'm not gonna make them go through that again. So some of them, I automatically just turn down just right away. But if it's something historical and ghost wise, I loved helping them. But nothing that's gonna. I'm not in for the boo factor, and I've had a lot of people say they would rather just have a TV show where they're, telling this story, and it doesn't necessarily have to be like, scary woo-woo. If they have a, an interesting tale of a nice ghost, that would be fine with them too. So, a ghost that saves somebody, a ghost who saves somebody or a ghost that, is comforting, that could be a good story too, but. A lot of the production companies, they want that scare factor. So.
Yeah, that's very true. Well, because if they want to do something television wise, it's all about the ratings. And I know I've talked to a couple people that have been on some of these shows, and one of them was on Ghost Hunters International, I think one of the first or second season. And the reason that they quit was because in the new contract, they realized that the show was going to be such a hit, it was doing so well, they had new contracts, and part of it was they had the option of redoing scenes or making things not as spontaneous the way we like them and try to trump up the evidence and stuff. And they said, I love doing this. I love going all over the world, but I won't be back for season 3.
Right.
And you
got to
respect those people.
Yeah, exactly. It is true. And then, that's, how I would always be if it happened to me, because I'm not going to, I've been doing this a long time. I'm not going to lose my credibility by going on and making something up or pretending something happened. Yeah, pretending something happened. No.
Like I said, there are very few things that we have in life that we can, we take with us all through our life, and our credibility, our morals is a big part of it. And I'm not about to do that either.
No
way.
Right.
Years ago, we had a bed and breakfast that was opening, and they said it was haunted. Went down there and did an investigation, and actually didn't get much, EVP-wise or anything. And they got a little upset with us because we didn't get anything. Well, I'm sorry you can't, but we're not going to be the ones that are going to make you build as a haunted bed and breakfast. It's
right.
I'm not going to make stuff much just so you can make money off of it. So.
I know. That happened to me with a restaurant one time. It was this little restaurant in Phoenix, and they called us down there, and I think it was, they were about ready to go out of business, so they thought, well, if we have a haunted restaurant, this will, perk up business, because it was in the height of all this stuff. And it was like nothing was there, and it's like, And then it was back a year later I got contacted by some other production company that was going to do a auction. It was a show about auctioning haunted items, and they showed me the picture of the item, and they showed me, you know, the email, the person who sent it to them, and I'm like, these are the same people I had at a haunted restaurant. I kind of don't think this item is probably not haunted. They just want to be on TV. So we never did that episode either. It's like, you know, go ahead.
Go on. Well, I think this place finally had a bunch of teams go through it and finally found one that, you know, got something, and now it's, you know, billed as a haunted bed and breakfast.
Yeah. A lot of them just want that prestige. I remember when I first started doing this 20 years ago, a lot of places didn't want that stigma. You know, you'd go to a hotel and... Yeah, you go to a hotel and, oh, no, it's not haunted. We don't want the guests to think it's haunted. They won't want to stay. They'll leave, and, you know, and it's like, you know, we have sneak into the basements and things like that. I mean, you know, now it's like, oh, do you want to see our haunted basement? Yeah. And, you know, and same thing with restaurants. They didn't want that stigma, but now they do because they found out that it does bring in, you know, customers in many cases. So, you know, it's kind of funny how it's changed through the years.
and it's all, you know, it's all revolved around that green piece of paper. Places here in the Midwest, or wherever we are, we're still kind of everybody seems to be kind of scared that, like we're talking about, nobody wants something to be haunted. We just not as open-minded. Up in Chicago, it's a little bit better, but down here in the cornfields and bean fields, everybody's still kind of, I don't know about that. How are the places out there in Arizona? They seem to be pretty open to
They're more open to
paranormal.
Yeah, they're more open to it now. There are still a few places that don't, you know, sometimes you'll visit a restaurant and they were that was really haunted, or same thing with a hotel, and then they change ownership, and then, you know, they have another outlook on life, or, you know, their religion, you know, teaches them not to believe in ghosts, and all of a sudden, like, it's not haunted, it's like they just went away, whatever. And then they sell it, and the next person comes along, and then it's haunted again. So just, you know, I think it depends on people's lifestyles and their, you know, sometimes the religious beliefs and everything like that. But for the most part, you know, they've come to find out that, you know, there are a lot of ghosts out here, you know, from the Wild West, because a lot of these people that died in gunfights and, you know, drug overdoses and everything like that, they kind of end up having unsettling spirits, because a lot of them left the East, you know, and left their families, and nobody ever knew where they went. And so when they passed away, you know, they were just kind of here, you know, in some cases. Nobody back East ever knew of them again. So sometimes they're a little unsettling because, you know, there's nobody here for them. So, yeah, so a lot of the businesses have finally realized that, this was kind of a wild and crazy place here in the early 1900s even, you know. So, you know, we're still new out here, you know, than compared to the Midwest and the East Coast. I was in... I was in Boston last fall, and I was just like totally, you know, it kind of blows you away that, like, they're 300, 400 years old, and Phoenix is just like, oh, we're like 100 years old. That's it, you know. So,
right,
you know, so much history.
Third
to the last state. Alaska and Arizona and New Mexico were the last four. Yeah. So we're just a baby state. We just had our centennial, you know, a couple of years ago. So,
right, I remember that.
So it's just, you know, so like a lot of our ghost stories are like new, you know, in the last 100 years or so. But we do have a lot of energy from, you know, like the Hohokam Indians. This is interesting fact. You know, the cemetery where I do all my volunteering, there's actually a prehistoric village underneath the cemetery that has a cemetery. So not only do we have, you know, modern day the dead on there, underneath the ground, there's a whole village with a cemetery, because they have, you know, done, you know, digs and things on there. They actually had to put a new sewer line in between the street in between the two cemeteries about 3 years ago. And, you know, once they start digging the sewer line, they, you know, hit the, you know, the little rooms of the village again. So they had to halt that for about 2 or 3 months while they did the dig. And so I would go down, I wouldn't even mess around. I'd go sit down in the dig and watch them because it was really interesting. But at one end of the, you know, the sewer line, the road, they start hitting where the where they buried the dead. So it's, I just always tell everybody, this is kind of a neat story, you know. You know, there's the city of the dead underneath the city of the dead. So that makes it kind
that
of fun.
That is very cool.
Yeah. And there's all kinds of pottery in the cemetery. Yeah. I can walk around there, you know, like after rain and all kinds of pottery washes up. And so then I stick it and I lay it on different tombstones, you know, because you don't want to walk out with that stuff. And you're just taking back bad mojo with you. that's another
exactly.
thing, you know, like cemetery etiquette's kind of a bad thing around here. I know just recently there was some vandalism in one of the cemeteries. The Arizona Historical Society contacted me to see if I knew anything about it. And, I don't know what people think sometimes when they're out in the cemeteries and they just, you know, kind of run through them. We clean them up. We usually take bags and, you know, pick up the trash and, mm-hmm. you know, and try to keep them nice. But then there's other people that, you know, have parties in them, or somebody ran through our cemetery one night, just we were knocking down stones. And then luckily one of the local stone mortuary companies came and put things back for us. But, you know, etiquette is kind of different with people in cemeteries. And we take groups out there. We try to remind them to, you know, not run in the cemetery. They just need to walk, you know, to walk around things and don't pick up things that are on the ground. Even though it's a nice rock, that rock might belong to, you know, one of the grave sites. So, so you have to always be on guard on that. And it's, you know, it's another thing on the cemetery crawl too, you know, because sometimes they get a little anxious and they come tearing into the cemetery and they automatically have to wait and be the last car to leave then when they pull that prank. And then they don't speed in the cemetery anymore. So lots of little funky rules, yeah.
Well, a lot of our cemeteries are out in the boonies, in the middle of the cornfield.
Mm-hmm.
If you look for the highest ground around in the county, chances are pretty good, I believe, of finding a cemetery on top of it. And in the summer, they're surrounded by either cornfields or bean fields or something, and you don't even know they're there. But the local kids do, and that's where they'll go out and have little parties and drink some beer.
One of my favorite cemeteries growing up in Nebraska was out in the middle of a cornfield, and I was probably the most haunted one I've ever been in my life. It's called Ball Cemetery, and it's near Springfield, Nebraska. It's a little tiny cemetery, but boy, does it have energy. And I remember going there in high school being so scared to even drive to it, you know, and, you know, and now when I see it, it's like, it's still creepy. I was there not long ago, and it still kind of creeped me out. I mean, it's just one of those things. You get in, walk in that gate, and you feel that energy of someone's watching you. You know, they definitely have a walker on that one. I was going to say, our cemeteries in Arizona are so blah compared to, like, the East Coast and, you know, in the southern states and probably, like, on the West Coast. I mean, we're just all, like, desert. And if we have one that has green grass in it, you're like, oh, wow, this is trees, you know. We don't have those elaborate stones like they have back east, but there are a few because obviously some of the people from back east came here and they wanted the nice stones like they had back there. So it's just totally different, you know, type of stones than back east.
But I noticed that because if you watch my Facebook page once in a while, I'll put up some pictures of stones up in the Chicago cemeteries, which huge mausoleums and stuff. Beautiful, beautiful stuff.
Oh, yeah. They have some beautiful
ones
there.
When I was out there, oh, they are. When I was out in Tucson over the holidays, my sister and I went to, I can't remember the name of the cemetery. It's on the east side. It's a long, it's a very large one. It's the largest one in Tucson.
Evergreen, I think.
Yes, you're right.
Yeah.
Went there and we just she saw all these pictures I took of cemeteries, and she said, "Why? What do you do?" So I just take some pictures. I said, "Let's go in here and I'll take some pictures." And we both ended up taking so many pictures, where I got her into the cemetery, and I found one marker that was a white bronze marker, and I explained to her what a white bronze one was, and it was getting all kind of rusty and stuff. But I explained all this stuff to her, and I got her into it, which will be cool. I'm sorry, go on.
The old Tucson Cemetery actually has a really nice old section, and it does have some really nice, stones in there and some zinkers and nice big marble ones and everything. I like the really old section of that cemetery. And I think Holy Hope is right there next to it too, and they have some nice ones as well. They're kind of connected, Evergreen and Holy Hope. So it looks like it's one big one, but it's actually two. Yeah.
Right. There's that little creek that runs down the middle of it.
I
was really surprised was the Hispanic part of the cemeteries. Where they had Christmas trees set up.
Christmas trees, little benches.
I was really surprised by that.
Yeah, they'll go there and have a picnic with their family, and it's always really colorful flowers, and I've seen barbecue pits there at some of them where they've made lunch and. Yeah, it's like a regular fiesta with their families, when they go to visit.
Yeah.
And, they almost always have a little bench or something. Yeah.
Yeah. And that's the way, the cemeteries used to be years ago. People would go there for a Sunday afternoon, leave church and take a picnic lunch out to the cemetery and sit there and visit their relatives
Or walk around, look at the artwork, because some of the tombstones and statues were beautiful pieces of artwork. And if you had a grave along the main walkway, close to the walkway, you were very prominent because you wanted to show off your family stones and everything. So it was always, if your tombstone and your family was along the actual walkway and pathways, you were, well-to-do, and you wanted to, like I said, show off your wonderful tombstones. The ones that were for the poor families were farther back. That's the way it used to be. And they did, they did. They had pathways and little places to sit. And, we recently put a gazebo down in our cemetery in Phoenix. So, we now can have weddings there if we want, or we have guest speakers speak there. And it's, a little band in there if we needed to, with some soft music or whatever, so nice.
Yeah.
We've been trying to do events down at the cemetery to kind of get people to come back. We had in January, we had people come down. We made Victorian Valentines in our little house that we have there, our offices are. In February, we had a reburial a celebration. Earlier, about a year and a half ago, they were building a new sheriff's office in Phoenix, and it's being built on the site of the original cemetery that was in effect from about 1870s to 1884, and it wasn't there very long, and they moved everybody to the current old cemetery. Well, they always miss a body here and there.
Right.
And so they started digging to build the sheriff's office, and they ran across there were two children, small children bodies, and then pieces of other things. So they had to run DNA and do all kinds of testing on it for about a year. And they were going to just put them in a pile and bury them in the county cemetery. We went like, no. They would have been moved to our cemetery had they been found back then. So we have an empty space in one of our plots, and we want them here. So what they did is everybody was like in a little shoebox, because there wasn't much of me, like a hand from somebody and a foot from somebody.
Right,
and, of course,
right.
the little children were intact. But so they, everybody had their own little box, and they had like a mass grave, and they buried them in our cemetery. So last month we did like a big celebration, and we had like a little mock funeral, and it was really nice. And then this month we're having the walk this Saturday. And in April, one of the ladies is with the Ladies of the Confederacy, so it's going to be on the Confederate Memorial Day. She's doing a little program. And then, of course, in May we have the big Memorial Day, you know, celebration. They've been doing that for years and years, probably 20-some years. And then we kind of take it off in the summer because it's just too hot, June and July and August. So we'll do another thing in September. Then, of course, in October is when we do Dining Among the Dead, which has been a big hit. We've done that for 2 years now, and it's grown bigger and bigger every year. Having a candlelight dinner with white tablecloths and covered chairs. It's beautiful out there.
Wow.
So we use the greens and purples and black to kind of give it that spook effect, but yet it's very Victorian and elegant. Everybody dresses up. We have a lot of people from the steampunk society comes, and everyone else kind of dresses up in period clothing, or you know, whatever you know strikes your fancy. Some people just come in jeans and a shirt, but most everyone dresses up. It's kind of like Halloween for adults.
Yeah.
So everybody can you know be someone from the past. And last year we had the gentleman. His name is actually Wyatt Earp, and he actually does a one man play on Wyatt Earp, and he looks just like Wyatt Earp when he was older. And this year he's coming back, and he's going to do Doc Holliday. And he does like a 20-minute little you know skit for everybody. And so it's really gets you into the mood of it. So.
We have about 8 minutes left of the show, and
okay.
I want to get into
uh-huh.
I want to get maybe one or two of your books in, talking about it
okay.
here. The Sleeping with Ghosts, A Ghost Hunter's Guide to Arizona's Haunted Hotels and Inns.
Yeah, well, that one's been out about 10 years now, and it has, you know, a lot of the hotels around Arizona. So as you're traveling about the state, a lot of people tell me to keep this one in their car with their maps, and they know, you know, which hotels to check into, which rooms to get if they want to be with the ghosts, and which ones to stay out if they don't want to be with the ghosts. So that one has been very popular, and it's been around quite a long time. Grand Canyon Ghost Stories is one that a publisher commissioned me to do about the Grand Canyon, and that one was in the beginning was quite tough because there was hardly ever any stories about ghosts in the Grand Canyon. So I actually had to go up there and hike around and you know talk to the river runners, the mule, you know, drivers, and the rangers, mm-hmm. and people in shops, hotel people, and so it covers everything from the bottom of the canyon to the north, south, east, west perimeter of the Grand Canyon, all the gateways. And then the last one I have, I don't know if I gave you that information, it's called the Graveyard Shift, and it's Arizona's Historic and Haunted Cemeteries. So this one has a little bit of history about some of the cemeteries and kind of the unique things that in it, and then also we talk about some of the more haunted cemeteries around Arizona. And that one's been out about a little over a year. So, you know, so I like that one, too. It kind of goes hand-in-hand with Sleeping with Ghosts because it's more Arizona stories. And, you know, as you travel around the state, it's all broke down by the different counties and everything. So go ahead.
Well, what would you say is your favorite Arizona ghost story?
My favorite Arizona ghost story? Oh, there's so many. I kind of like some of the stories that happened on the cemetery crawl. For example, we were in a cemetery that is noted to be with a ghost town, and we were waiting for the crawlers to arrive, and we look up on a hill, and we saw some people walking in this other nearby cemetery, and we just thought it was our people. They had gone to the wrong place, so I send the guys up there to go get them, to bring them down to where I was. And they get up there, and I see the truck driving around, and they come back. They go, there was nobody there. And I go, but we all saw them. And we go, yeah, we know there's, you know, but there was, like, no tire tracks. There's no footprints. We saw some hunters on the road and asked if anybody had come out of there. So we saw ghosts that weekend. So that was kind of cool. That was kind of a fun thing. I think the Gadsden Hotel in Douglas, Arizona is probably my favorite hotel because that's where we first started going ghost hunting, and every time we go back there, it's always an adventure. I know there's just so many because I've been to so many places around Arizona. You know, up at the Hotel Vendome, and we've slept in the bottom of the Grand Canyon Caverns. They reported that as haunted. And that was kind of just a unique experience in itself, being they say, you know, that you slept in this cave down, you know, 120 feet or wherever it was. But that was very cool. That was kind of a cool haunting. But I've enjoyed every place I've been. Yeah.
Well, that's cool. That is very cool. Well, so we just have a couple minutes left here. If people want to get a hold of you or buy your books, I put the Amazon link up a couple times. Is that the best place, or the only place that they can get your books, or off of a website?
They can contact me. My email is naza@aol.com, because I always have a supply here at the house, and that way I can send them and sign them at the same time too. So that's a good way. Or you can go on to, you know, I have a Facebook page, just the author page, and just my regular Facebook. I probably have like three different Facebook pages like everybody does now. Or you can go on to MVD Ghost Chasers. That's the team page. So I do a lot of book signings here and there. Just usually I announce them on the websites and on Facebook too. But yeah, just contact me here at the house, because I'm usually writing 24/7. So I usually see things right away.
Now on Amazon with the Sleeping with Ghosts, it says there's only two left in stock. Do you have copies of that one?
Yeah, I do. I have copies of everything here. I'm sure they have more in stock. I think they do that to entice you.
Well, okay, maybe so. That always works.
There's other people that sell them that are, you know, probably used too, and they probably have them in stock too. But yeah, I always have all my books here in stock, because when I travel, I always have to take a few with me. Because if I don't, then they ask for them. If I don't have them with me, they want them. If I take a pile with me, then no one asks. So I just, automatically. Yeah, I just automatically carry some in the car wherever I go.
Well, save a couple for me, because I'll
definitely
get a hold of you and get them off of you, because I like to have the autographs and stuff in them. So just, I'll get back with you on that. Well, I want to thank you very, very much for being on the show tonight. It was fun talking to you. And
thanks for having me. I had fun too.
Hopefully this won't be the last time you'll be on Paranormal Geeks Radio, and we'll have you back on again, like before one of your other events. You can put a shout out to it and get it out there a little bit
more.
Yeah,
especially in October for Dining Among the Dead. That's our biggie. Yep.
Oh yes. Yeah, October's a big month for some reason.
And you should be here, so you should be coming up for that one.
I hope I can get out there. You don't know how bad I want out of here. Okay,
well,
again, thank you very much for being on tonight. And our next guest is a lot of Illinois ghosts, or not cemetery stuff. So if you want to hang on and just listen, you can, or you can call back. Yeah. But thank you very much for being on.
All right. All right, thank you. I'll just listen on the show.
All right, thank you, ma'am. All right. Now we are going to take a little bit of a break here. And when we come back, our guest will be Miss Angie Johnson, friend of mine from not too far from me here in Champaign or wherever I live. So we're going to play a couple of songs, and everybody can go crack open another bottle of Pepsi or wine or whatever, and you all come back in about eight to ten minutes.
I didn't get far, I'm trying. always a crazy one. Broke into the stadium and I wrote your number on the 50-yard line. You were always a perfect one and a valedictorian. So under your number I wrote, call for a good time. I only wanted to get your attention, but you overlooked me somehow. Besides, you had too many boyfriends to mention, and I played my guitar too loud. How do you like me now? How do you like me now? Now that I'm on my way, you still think I'm crazy standing here today. I couldn't make you love me, but I always dreamed about living in your radio. How do you like me now? Then you married in the money, girl. Ain't it a cruel and funny world? He took your dreams and he tore them apart. He never comes home and you're always alone. And your kids hear you cry down the hall. Alarm clocks start ringing. Who could that be singing? It's me, baby, with your wake-up call. How do you like me now? I'm on my way. You still think I'm crazy standing here today. I couldn't make you love me, but I always dreamed about living in your radio. How do you like me now?
Are you an experienced ghost hunter or just ghost curious? In either case, on your next trip to beautiful Branson, Missouri, make sure you visit Ghosts of Branson. Hi, I'm Dr. Chuck Kennedy, owner of Ghosts of Branson, with over 40 years of experience as a paranormal investigator and an author of over a dozen books. I have personally scouted the best location in the Ozarks. Branson is the vacation capital of America. It is less than a one-day drive to one-third of the U.S. population, and at Ghosts of Branson, we have the ghost tour or investigation that is right for you. On all of our tours, each location is investigated and documented. You won't just hear stories and folklore. Using the night show technology, you will see the photographs and video and hear the EVPs that confirm each location is haunted. Are you a member of a group? Well, then check out our Ghost Hunters Getaway, a weekend to die for. 3 great days of ghost hunting events that you will never forget. So don't wait. Check out ghostsofbranson.com and book your tour or weekend now. Remember, don't let your vacation be normal. Make it paranormal with Ghosts of Branson.
Well, welcome back to Paranormal Geeks Radio. I'm your host, Jim Heater. If in this second half, if you have any questions for myself or for our next guest, it is area code 347-826-9996. That's 347-826-9996. Our next guest has been a cemetery photographer since 2003, and she has photographed over 1,329 cemeteries. I bet you it's 1,330 by now. She has volunteered many of her photos in she's volunteered many of her photos to Illinois counties and state cemetery websites throughout the year, photographing full counties. Hang on, something keeps popping up here on the screen, and it goes over what I have. Photographing full counties and traveling the entire state, which she keeps on her website, walkamongthedeadgirl.com. That's walkamongthedeadgirl.com, all one word. She's also very active in some cemetery restoration dealings, which we're going to talk about in a minute here. So I'd like to go ahead and bring her on, our guest, the second guest tonight, Ms. Angie Johnson. How are you tonight, Angie?
I'm good. How are you, Jim?
I am not doing bad at all. Now that we have some decent weather, we can get started on some stuff. First off,
I'm ready to get out there.
Get all muddy. Tell us how you got interested in photographing all these cemeteries. I know I've been on with you on a couple trips, and we spend maybe 5-10 minutes at a cemetery. Hop in the car and scoot off to another one. We did, 26, 27 in one day?
Yeah. About 10 years ago, I took a photo for Matt Hutke for graveyards.com. Matt has one of the greatest websites in Illinois. As far as his website shows you the location and gives you a photograph of what the front entrance is, the sign. So when people who are going to the cemeteries looking at families, can see the kind of condition what the cemetery is going to be in. It's a great website. A lot of states don't have websites like this. I found it very hard when I travel out of state to find a website that has everything. You can kind of Google map it and see stuff. But math is really good. I mean, it gives you the location, latitude. It gives you them per county. So, his mostly have the registered cemeteries in the state of Illinois. It takes volunteers to do full counties, to where gives him more cemeteries in that county. So he's got people who've done whole counties and sent it to him. It got to the point to where I was volunteering. I was his biggest volunteer. And eventually he's like, Angie, you've just done so many. We need to have your own website. So from there, he's my website host.
Very cool. So what really got you into the cemetery deal? Photographing flowers or something.
I've always traveled to them. I've always liked them when I was younger, a teenager. And, of course, we never vandalized or anything. It was just the curiosity of being out there. My parents always took us to our family's graves as children on Memorial Day, holidays we decorated. At the time when I first started donating to Matt, I had a daughter. Our first daughter passed away almost 20 years ago. So I would go to the cemetery a lot. And then when I was looking for the information for our rules here in our town on our cemetery, I came across graveyards.com, and I volunteered the first photograph. And then he was so thankful and asked me about doing it. I said, yes, I've been to all in the county. And it just took off from there. And I think for me, it was more like a scavenger hunt, because when you go to the cemeteries, they're never the same. There's always something different. People leave the neatest things. And like Dee Dee said, there's so much history. You can walk and tell, cemeteries are connected. The people are connected in them. So mostly these people have traveled together from other parts, from the east here. So you'll see all these different families, in this one cemetery, and they're all married into each other. So it's just very interesting. You see how the children died. You see if a tornado went through. There's just so many things, and Illinois has some fabulous cemeteries, and the history is wonderful here.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it definitely is. So since you did all the cemeteries and stuff, what got you into the cemetery restorations? And you also have a group now of restorers.
Yes, I have a brand new group. There is 17 of us. There's a few that help when I go to their county. I'll tell you what, it makes such a difference in my life because a lot of people who do restoration go into the cemetery and they'll just fix it. My team is full of genealogists, and not only do we fix it, but we make new books for those cemetery board members or the owners of the history of the people buried there and how they're connected. And the reason why I do this, because in the state of Illinois, when you get trained with the Illinois Historical Preservation Agency, when you work in an unregistered cemetery, it is mandatory that you go back and do the history of the people buried there. So it's always good when you're doing a restoration here that you get used to doing that. And it's nice because one of the cemetery boards that I restored, Peck Cemetery, which is almost done, it's over 300 burials, and there's a lot of big stuff in there. They had a fire in one of the members' homes, and they lost everything. They lost deeds. They lost mapping. And Gary Van Winkle, one of the members, he's had to try to find what he can for that. So with Peck, I totally remapped the cemetery for them. Family members came and gave me photographs, wedding certificates, deeds, whatever they had,
wow.
And we're able to make these new books for them. So, and we don't only just help the cemetery board, we also help the library and the genealogy society. So when I do these books, we make sure everybody's getting it. So people who are looking for family members have a place to go.
Well, that's very cool. Now, they also, the state has some pretty interesting classes you have to take, and you have to be certified by the state to even start doing any of this stuff, correct?
Well, it's not actually that you're certified. It's a training. Here in Illinois, we have laws for our cemeteries. Some states don't. Iowa, Indiana, Ohio, I believe Kentucky, they don't really have laws to help with their cemeteries. So pretty much anybody can go in and start working on a cemetery, whether they're trained or not. And you don't want to do that because there's too many mistakes made. People like stones and concrete. They drill holes inside of these stones to put them up with braces. A lot of people even use chalk on stones to get worrying stuff. You know, you don't want to do that to your stones. They're old and they're brittle. So you want them to get it to last as long as you can. So I call the IHPA, which is the Illinois Historical Preservation Agency, they're out of Springfield. And it is our state's anthropologist and archaeologist. And they do travel a couple times a year. They give a beginner's class, which you have to take first, and then an advanced class in the fall. And you learn how to preserve, not restore, but preserve what you see in these cemeteries. And they have laws to protect our unregistered cemeteries in our state. Your registered cemeteries have a cemetery board. They'll have like a township board, or somebody's already taken care of it. So it's these little tiny cemeteries you're seeing out in the woods that has private property all the way around them that you go to have to ask somebody to cross their land to get to. These are what you're calling unregistered cemeteries. So this is what the state law protects, and this is what they're teaching you to do on these cemeteries.
Yeah, no, I was really amazed by there's a cemetery that hopefully we're going to be working on in the next couple of years, but the amount of paperwork, you posted a picture of it on Facebook.
Yeah.
And it was a massive amount of paperwork. It was probably at least 6, 7, 8 inches, you know, high of stuff you had to get ready.
Well, there's mapping, for one, of the location of the cemetery. There are forms you have to fill out with the state. When I started doing the restoration 3 years ago, after I got trained and I got advanced, plus I've taken mortar classes with a gentleman that lives close to me that does restoration, I was never informed about how much paperwork there is. But what it honestly is doing is it's able to provide that next person that goes in after you, if it ever gets vandalized or needs worked again in the years, to show what work you did. And it also shows them how everybody's connected from that area right there. So, you know, once you've done the paperwork once, the second time is a breeze. But you have to do paperwork to get the permit. You have to have the landowners or cemetery board sign this form. And then afterwards, you have to – the paperwork afterwards is a lot. I fixed 2 stones down south of Ashmore. And Becky Guyman, who lives down there, and myself, we went in. I got the permission. The owner signed the paperwork. It was no big deal. It took me like maybe an hour to extend the base stone because one of the stones was broke by the worst, so I took it home, extended the base. And then we went down to the cemetery, and it took an hour and a half to put the two stones up. So in 2.5 hours, we fixed these stones. It took me 4 days to fill out the paperwork. So, you know, it's well worth it, though, because you're doing a great thing. And we fixed those stones from a lady from California, and she was just so excited about it. She couldn't believe that somebody would actually do that for her.
Now, explain a little bit about that, how the lady, about this situation.
She lives in California, and she was doing research on Charles Cox and his brother Ellis. He was in Fort Donelson, and he died, and his brother Ellis died about 9 years old, I believe, and he died on Christmas Day. Well, they had made a trip in their RV up to Wisconsin. They decided on the way back that they would drive through. And when they got around Ashmore area, people kept saying the wrong direction. Well, the cemetery is a little bit hard to see when the corner's up because it's more in a little wooded area outside the road behind a barn. And they drove all day long, and she went home, and she said, I was just very upset. And she goes, as soon as I got home, I got on the computer, and I get on graveyards.com, and there's a photograph of Charles Stone. She goes, I was so excited, and I contacted Matt, and Matt got a hold of me, and he says, can you help her? And I said, sure. So I called her. And she goes, can I use the photo? I'm making a quilt. And I said, sure, no problem. So I sent her the photos from there, and she goes, there's one missing. She goes, there's an Ellis there. And I said, there was a stone laying on the ground. So I went down, and I took more photos for her. She was just like, I can't believe you would drive down there, because here I live in B-Man. I live like two counties away. And I said, not a problem. I have friends there. I go there. I'll go back and know exactly where it's at. And so I went back, and I came, and she had told me during the time that I came back and got the photos, I told her to be a little while, that they sold their RV. They would not be able to travel back out, and they got one of those homes that you move in, you know. It's not assisted living, but they sold their house and moved in. She goes, you know, we just can't travel like we did. And she goes, I just feel really sad that I wasn't able to photograph these. And I was like, well, you know, I will go down and take a look and talk to the owner and just kind of, you know, see what I can do. Well, I ended up calling the state with it being a registered cemetery, and I called her back, and I said, you know what, I'm going to fix all of the stone for you. And, I mean, the tears of joy, it's just amazing. We actually have a YouTube account called Straightforward, Joe Dyer and I do, and we have the videos. We were able to YouTube their whole story telling us how they came here. And we actually videoed the fixing of the stones. We do that. My restoration team, we video things, and we show people, and we try to teach people. The thing, though, is, you know, even though I'm doing these restorations, sorry about the train, even though I'm doing these restorations, in the next few years, I want to help teach throughout the state. But even though you learn from John Hyder and myself how to do restoration, and we do big cemeteries, we do big stuff. You know, we do these little farm ones and stuff too, because I enjoy doing the ones that people forget about. But you still have to go through the state to take your training, because the state will not give you a permit for an unregistered cemetery if you don't do this. So you can come work with us, but if you go on your own, you still have to take the classes.
Okay. So what all?
We fixed it for the lady, and they were very happy.
Well, the one cemetery you you just finished, or you're still working on, have a little bit left to do, Peck Cemetery. You said that had about 300 burials in it, correct?
Yes, and it was vandalized. Troy Taylor.
Yeah, you didn't have to work on all 300, did you?
I worked on a lot. I worked on everything. I touched every single stone.
Wow.
Troy Taylor has written about Peck being one of the most haunted cemeteries in central Illinois. It's about 10 miles from my house. And I think after growing up, everybody in my area has always went there at night, you know, looking to see something, you know, that happened. It's just very well famous. It's just famous here. So when I had my paranormal team, we wanted to go tent there, and Gary Van Winkle let us go out there on Halloween night. And I just knew right then and there, you know, I was going to be leading my team to do AGS, and I knew this was a cemetery that I wanted to fix. So eventually I approached him about it, and I did have events there. I did raise the money for that. It was a great first year. I had psychic mediums come. We had Michael Clean come. We did ghost hunts, and I pretty much raised all the money for this restoration. the restorations that I do now, I don't do that because it's too time consuming. And now that I do so much with the state, I just really don't have time to set up these events. So normally, I just talk to the owners about how much it's going to cost them to fix, or the board members, and they normally pay for it. Or my team comes in together and we pay for the materials.
Sweet. That's that'd be the way to do it.
Yeah, it will be done by the first part of June, I'm hoping. There's not a lot left there. Out of all the stones, I was pretty much able to fix everything. There was 16 people I was able to identify, so we're getting 16 new stones for them. They're not anything big and extravagant, but I work with Adams Memorial out of Charleston, and for $35, I can get them an 8x10 nice marble little stone. So we'll, at least we'll get their identification back. But I still have about 8 or 10 people, because we work with Find a Grave. We find out who that volunteers for that cemetery, and then we work with them and update them and get the new pictures up and stuff. And the Find a Grave lady keeps sending me obituaries, and I have no idea where these people are buried. So I have about 10 people I can't identify in there.
Now, with the memorials, with the stones that are donated by Adams, is it the stones plus the engraving on them, or is it just
and they
the
don't
stone?
Donate them. It cost me $35 a stone.
$35.
So
right.
About $600, and I'll be able to replace 16 stones. I'll be able to put them down. So I'm kind of excited about that, because we only have a few things left to do there, and we're done. We have a cemetery in North Piatt. Larry Pike is doing the restoration there. He is from Mansfield. This is a one headstone out in the middle of a field. Mr. Vandermeer, George Vandermeer's grave is there. He was killed by a pack of wolves, him and his horse, on the way to the store, and he lived not too far away from there, and they buried them there. And the thing about it is, our genealogy society had said that there was only a headstone there. There was only a rock there to identify his grave. Well, once I got there with Larry, this gentleman had a headstone. So I was very excited to see that, and we got a hold of the landowner, and it is unregistered, so I've already got the permit back for that, and we will be fixing that, and that will probably happen in June. And then we will be going at the end of June, beginning of July, down to the old slave house in southern Illinois to fix both cemeteries there. There's Hickory Hill and Loyler. Hickory Hill has John Crenshaw, which Jim is doing the research to. And then Loyler has General Michael Loyler, who I'm doing the research to. These cemeteries are right up next to each other. General Loyler is the son-in-law of John Crenshaw, who owned the slave house, which, if some of you don't know what the old slave house is, the old slave house, he was at one time an underground railroad. He owned the salt mines. Of course, he didn't pay his taxes, so he had to get rid of it. But he became known as a reverse underground railroad. He was the old slave house is the most northern slave house in the United States. And he breeded slaves and sold them. He also would get slaves, and he would turn around and sell them back to the slave state. And he got in a lot of trouble for that. So he was very brutal to them. He locked them upstairs. It was like almost a stable. He would beat them, torture them. It's very brutal, and it's really hard because in this restoration, I'm starting to become well-known down in southern Illinois because of radio and the TV and all that, want to do interviews. But the Underground Railroad and I have been talking with their website, and they've asked me if I would like to write something for it. But what do you say when you're fixing this evil man's stone on the site that is for the people that he hurt? So it's kind of difficult, but it is a part of our history no matter what, and you fix it, you know. And that's my whole thing, is I'm not prejudiced to any cemetery no matter what, because our cemeteries do need to be taken care of.
Yes, and this one isn't pretty bad. It's not in terrible, terrible shape.
No, there was actually, it wasn't vandalized. There was a storm several years ago, and the actual Crenshaw burials on that side by the trees is worse than what the Loyler burials are. So,
right. And tell us a little about the Lawler side.
I've only started doing the research for it. General Lawler was very famous in the Civil War. He married John Crenshaw's daughter, and they had lived in the house for a while. His family actually is the ones that donated the land to the Catholic Church. I had to go back and find out who owned the property, because you have to do that. And it was the people that were going down, the Shoe family that were going down to help, I guess for years, everybody down there has been trying to find out. Within about 6 hours, I was able to find out. I called the title company, and they had actually done the research and found out the Catholic Church owned it. So I got my paperwork the next day, and it was nice. One thing about the cemetery, there's people that live around it, and there's a brand new house back there. So it's not, they don't worry about vandalism. Equality is not big at all. If you blink, you miss. You know, so
right.
I think it'd be nice to do this restoration. And then this fall we have one in Cross Cemetery, which is another Oakley Township. We'll also be helping Bourbon Township, which comes up. They're down by Arthur. You know, I enjoy fixing the more haunted cemeteries, the ones that have the history. I just enjoy being there. I've worked in Old Macomb. I worked in Greenwood, in Decatur. Of course, I've done the whole cemetery at Peck. And another one I would like to do is in DeWitt called Old Union. It needs some work. But as a team, I think for us, it's good to work together and figure out what we want to do, because we are working in probably about 9 different counties. And some of us travel, you know, the whole state. We'll go somewhere and to do a restoration if we really want to do it. If it's very historical, you know, I have a problem. But I always get these people who call and say, hey, can you come fix our cemetery? I'm like, we're really swamped, but I can get you help. I can show you where you can get trained. And, you know, it's a possibility that you or someone in your area can get trained to go do these kind of things.
Right, because how far down from us is Equality? That's
that's 3.5 hours.
Yeah,
you're almost to Kentucky.
Right, yeah, we're real close to Indiana and real close to Kentucky there, to both.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this is all on our dime.
Yeah. You know, I love Southern Illinois. My last year, I do cemetery crawls, too. They're a little bit different than DD's. We actually talked about it the other night. You know, hers, like she was saying, is more like the Amazing Race, which sounds, you know, really exciting. Ours is a little more laid back. We go as a group together on a 2-day trip. We start out at 7 o'clock in the morning, and I'm going to post the last year's crawl on it for people to see, but we travel all together, and people pay for their own rooms, you know, the night before and then the middle night that we stay. And we just go from cemetery and historical spot. I normally work on that map starting about Thanksgiving, and by the time spring comes, I pretty much know everywhere we're going to go, and then I do the drive ahead of time where I time it. And it's fun. We had a great time last year. We started out in Harrisburg. We went to some cemeteries there. Then we went to Garden of the Gods, went to Cave and Rock, we went to Metropolis, Golconda, and then we went to Fort Matesac. And then the second day, you know, we went over to Grand Tower, we went to Murfreesboro, went to Boone Cemetery, which is one of my favorite cemeteries in the state of Illinois. Bennington Boone, his father came from Kentucky. And when he moved here, he dropped the E on the back of his name. But he is related to Daniel Boone. Well, Bennington was the first white child born in, I believe it's Union County, might be Jackson. Anyway, sorry, Johnson. He fought under Abraham Lincoln and Davis. And when you climb up to the cemetery on the side of a petroglyph, you have to climb up real steep hill. It's all wooded. You get to the top, there is a beautiful tall, don't ask me how they got it up there, but a beautiful tall pyramid, and it has all these stones, and on a stone it says, you know, that he fought, you know, in the Black Hawk War for both of these men. When you come down from the cemetery and go around behind the mountain, there is where the Indians lived, and there is beautiful just Indian riding, there's waterfalls, and, you know, Southern Illinois is just gorgeous. I mean, I've been a lot, and I've been to Chicago, and I did go up to Galena last year on a 6-day trip. And, you know, it's just something about Southern Illinois I love. There's just so much to see. And we even followed the whole road that goes from the Trail of Tears, where the Cherokees were forced through in Southern Illinois. And some of the cemeteries actually Cherokees buried in there. So, you know, when I do these cemetery crawls, like this year we'll be in Central Illinois. We'll start out at Clark County. We'll go through Edgar, Coles, Douglas. And then the second day, I think we're through Moultrie, Christian, and Shelby. So we see as much as we can. And I work with paranormal teams in those areas because they have historians. And their historians are, you know, they know their stuff because they do these investigations. and they're already learning all these things. So then when I go to have them come with, they already know the stories behind all this stuff. So, and normally they're pretty right on it. The ones that I know, I work with my friends, so I pretty much know, you know, if they've done the work or not. I don't just pick anybody out of the blue. I guess I get a little picky about that only because I used to be an investigator, and I know, just like they're saying earlier, you know, some people just want to be on a team and don't really do the work. I rather work with people who know their stuff because I want to be able to give out the right information to these people. So my cemetery crawls are probably my most favorite thing to do all year long, besides travel and photograph cemeteries on my own.
That's very cool. I admire you for what you you've taken this bull by the horns, and you do a good work, and you don't leave us, no pun intended, a stone unturned.
Yeah, it's grown, you know. In 2012, I started the Associate of Gravestone Studies. I became a member, and I was seeing that it was growing. I had other friends in it. I was going to the meetings. I was enjoying the people I was seeing there. They were other cemetery enthusiasts, whether they were photographers or genealogists or restoration, you know, whatever it might be. It was still people that I could sit and talk to and feel very excited about what I'm talking about and that, and know that they're actually listening to me because, you know, I come home or I could be at work talking about it and everybody just blows and like, who cares, you know, we don't care. And it's like, you know, this is very important to me. So it was nice getting with other people. So in 2012, I started this Illinois State chapter, and we've grown. You know, we have our own page on Facebook. We've got up to about over 400 people now. And we're constantly spreading the word on the things that we do with AGS. You know, they have a national where everybody can come once a year. And this year, it's always the third week in June, and it's in Indianapolis, or it's Franklin College over in Indiana. And you can learn things. They have restoration classes. They have just all kinds of different things that you can learn when it comes to cemeteries. And then each chapter, which not every state has a chapter yet. I mean, we're growing. There's probably only about 7 or 8 states now that have one. And this organization started in Massachusetts, so it's very big out there. But it's just nice being around other people who have the same interests. And people say, oh, do people really get into cemeteries? Yeah, they do. And it's more than you know.
Yeah, it seems to be more and more people are becoming interested in them. And you know, like we were talking before with Debbie, it's trying to get people back into the cemetery and get the interest back and make sure that people respect the cemeteries.
Yeah, and, I know, and the thing is, go ahead, Jim.
Go ahead. No, you go ahead. You're the guest.
The thing is, I work with kids. I let the kids come and do their volunteer time with me in the cemetery. I'm talking about teenagers. And I write a lot. I have my own column in the paper here in this area where I live. And I find it very important that when you're a parent, this is when you teach your children. Your children learn from you. They follow you. They admire you. They listen to you. And taking your kids out at a very young age and either, you know, putting flowers on the grave or walking them through the cemetery and showing things, talking about your ancestors, this is where it starts. It starts at home. And when you can have a child who is raised and how to respect cemeteries, when their friends are around and they know how to treat them, then it's just one more child saying, don't do that. Don't go into the cemetery and don't play there. It's not to be played with. I have family there. And you almost have to ask the kid, when you talk to high schoolers about vandalism, you know, as a group, you say, how would you like it if somebody put you in their bedroom and they took your iPhone, they took your Xbox, and they went through all your stuff and just tore it up and threw it around and treated it like dirt? Kids don't like that. I mean, they lived the text. They lived it for their electronics. And when you put it that way to them and say, well, how would you feel if you went to the cemetery and somebody done that with your family's group? And, you know, it makes them think, how long would somebody terrorizing my stuff like that? And it's just the same thing, but you have to put it in their perspective to know that. So, you know, when we first put up the first stone at Peck, my daughter, who is now 15, and two of her best friends I took out there. We called all the family members who came and watched them, and they put up the first stone. It took them about an hour and a half, and I walked them through it. And they did a great job. And they were, and I wrote about it and put it in the paper. And everybody, that everywhere they went, they were like, congratulations, you did such a great job, you know. And even at school, the kids, I waited until school was in session before I did the story so their friends could see, you know. And they were so proud, and the parents were so proud. And that's just what you do. You really got to teach your kids when they're younger, you know, because when we're gone, who's going to take care of it, you know?
Exactly. So. Exactly. When I leave here, there's not going to be anybody here to take care of my my grandparents' grave here in Urbana and then down in Litchfield. There's not going to be anybody to go out and put flowers on them and stuff. Maybe I'll talk to my kids about that.
Yeah. And when you talk about cemeteries, there's so different aspects. Everybody has a different reason why they're doing cemeteries or, you know, or what they mean to them. And you know, I try to explain to people, you know, when you go in and vandalize a cemetery, a lot of these cemeteries don't have paperwork on some of these older ones. So you have lost total identification to these people, to where to put the stones back. And not only you have touched the lives of the police who have come because you've done the vandalism, the people that live around there because now they got to watch the place all the time, the cemetery board that has to go out and clean up the mess, the volunteers who come to fix the cemetery, the family members who have people buried there, the genealogists who go out and walk out that cemetery. You know, so when you do this, you're touching all these people because it has effect on all of them.
Yep.
You know, so, and people don't think about that. You know, with Peck, they brought a big truck in, they took a chain, they put it to one of the biggest stones in the cemetery, and they pulled it right off, and they drove right through it. And you could see, when I first started the restoration, the path they took, because everything was broke along that south side where they had driven in and drove through, you know. But now it's all back up, and it just looks great. And we even got the big stone up. You know, we have to bring tractors and straps in and bring that big stuff up. You know, I have tripod, but it doesn't even touch some of that big stuff we put up. You know, so you have to learn how to do. And, you know, nobody taught me how to do that. We had to learn. We had to do it on our own. So, but we got it. We got it done. And that's what you do. You go in. You know, I don't always go and do these big cemeteries, you know, that have these cemetery boards. Like, I would never go to Chicago and say, hey, you know, I'm going to fix your old cemetery, because they have people there to do that. But when you come down to more here where we live, and especially down south where they're harder to get to, you know, they need the help. So I just, you know, just go in and help you what you can do.
You just brought this up, so it's your fault. Are there any cemeteries up in Chicago you're interested in maybe trying to restore?
I've been asked to come help at one in Lake County. It's not a real big one, but it's a very historic one. That may be happening this year. It just depends. Right now it's in the works. I put a bid in to restore Bachelor's Grove, which is in Mitholeon. Everybody knows it to be one of the most haunted cemeteries on earth. The landowners do have the paperwork, and it's up to them to make the decision. We have talked back and forth. There are some decisions they want to make, and I think there's a possibility that, yes, it will be restored, but there will be some limitations. So right now, it's really on my back burner because I just have too much going on, and I'm trying to write a book of the travels here in Illinois, because, you know, there's so much here, and I've seen so much stuff, and I have more to see, you know. You know, I try to hit so many cemeteries on every trip. You know, it was funny because one day you said, when we go to McDonald's, we'll go out of our way to hit 17 cemeteries before we get to McDonald's, which was only like 8 miles away, you know? And I had to laugh when you said that because, you know, it's just like that. When I go on a trip, it's always mapping to see what I see, because it's an opportunity for me to either see the cemetery on a cemetery crawl or do a restoration there. So, you know. And I love historical things, too. I don't always just see the cemeteries. I also see the historical sites. And you put them all together because most likely it's connected to somebody in the cemetery.
Yeah, very true.
And I have some neat things. You know, Illinois is the only state that has ever had a king buried in it. King Peter was from Yugoslavia. He came out after the communism started there many years ago. And he moved out, I believe, to Colorado. Well, he had heart problems. And he wanted to be buried up in Lake County, north of Chicago, at a cemetery that also had Yugoslavians in it. It's called Sub Orthodox Churches there. It's all hand-painted when you walk in. It's gorgeous. Anyway, they buried him inside of there. His son became a king over in Yugoslavia, and this last January they came there. They came from Yugoslavia and had a beautiful ceremony, and they took King Peter back to Yugoslavia. But Illinois is the only state that's had a king buried in it. And then also we have Pig Neptune. Pig Neptune was a war bond pig. They spent millions of dollars on this pig to help raise money. The president had bought him, and they took the money to refix the Illinois ship back in the day. So he was very well taken care of. He was the only animal probably around that was ever on three different Masonic lodges memberships. And he is buried down south in southern Illinois. And then we also have two Abraham Lincolns here. You have our president, and you have his first cousin. His first cousin is buried up by Macomb in St. Simon Cemetery. I have a neat little story about that. I went to go take my last restoration class with the state. And, of course, you have to travel to those. They don't cost a lot, but you do have to go wherever they're going to be. So I went up to decided I would photograph the day before from Peoria clear to Iowa, to Keokuk, Iowa. And on my way there, I come across the big historical sign that says St. Simon Cemetery, historical. But you look, and I'm looking around like, there's no cemetery anywhere. There's a woods way back there, and I'm not walking it. So I stop at a neighbor's house and ask, and she goes, oh, yeah, this old fellow over here owns it, and he won't let anybody in there. And I said, well, where does he live? Oh, up the lane. She goes, where are you going? I said, I'm going there. He's not going to talk to you. And I said, I just said goodbye, thanks, and I left. And I went up the lane, and he's a retired fireman, and he was very nice, and he says, can you ride a four-wheeler? And I said, yeah. And he goes, let's go. So we went back on the four-wheeler and went back to the cemetery. It used to have a church in it, and still there, where the church used to sit. And then all these stones are laid down flat. They're in good condition. It's a very fixable cemetery, but, you know, he doesn't want, it's on private property. He has a right to tell people to stay out, and he just didn't want anybody back there. So we start photographing, and it was Abraham Lincoln's first cousin, Abraham. And my mother had called me on this trip, and, of course, I'm like, you know, I'll call you back. I'm in the middle of talking to somebody. You know, let me just call you when I get done. So I didn't think anything of it, and I was so excited that I was here because it's just very historical. I mean, here I am standing, Abraham's first cousin. His name is Abraham. So I visit with him, and then I left, and I call my mother back, and she says, I'm working for Ann Schabel, and she has this book for you about Abraham Lincoln's first cousin. She goes, he's in a cemetery out there. I said, oh, my God, I was just standing there, you know, and it was just amazing how that worked out. Well, the book she had given me talks about how Abraham Lincoln, the second cousin's father, was Mardesia, and he was the oldest of the boys. There was three. Him and his other brother had came from one lady, and then Thomas, which is the famous Abraham Lincoln's father, he had came from another lady. Well, they lived down in Kentucky, and their father's name was also Abraham. Well, where their cabin was, he was out hunting, and they witnessed an Indian kill Abraham. So the two older boys, Thomas and Mardesia, they ran back to the cabin, and this Indian chased them there. Well, the younger boy went and got the settlers. So when they got back to the cabin, Mardesia got a gun and put it through one of the holes. He shot the Indian. And behind the Indian was coming a big, huge tribe, but the settlers had got there in time to scare them away. So if it wasn't for Mardesia saving Thomas, we would not have an Abraham Lincoln today. So it was a very interesting story, and I did write about it in my column. I write about all these things in the column. I really want to write a book about all these different places that I've gone and the things that are buried in Illinois because they have such great history here. And my thing is, next year I'm getting ready to go out to Salem, Massachusetts. I really want to go out there. You know, there are first settlers here. My family, we were able to go back to the 1500s, and we are from Wales and England, and we were Finneys. And they are buried. They are the first Finneys that came to Plymouth, and they are buried in the Plymouth Cemetery, and I do plan on going there to take photographs for my family. So the history is amazing.
Yeah,
the cemetery holds so much, you know. And I hate to hear that you're going to Arizona. I'm very excited that you're on the team. I'm very excited that everybody that's helping on the team is. You know, they all are very excited. They're all very helpful, and I hope they learn. And I just hope everybody enjoys it this year. It's going to be a great year.
Yeah, really, it really will be. I'm really looking forward to it. And if everything falls together tomorrow for me, I'm still hanging around to get these things that I've committed to and doing the Crenshaw, doing the cemetery down there, Hickory Hill Cemetery, is one of the reasons I would stay, because I committed to it.
Yeah.
I'm not gonna. I can't think of doing anything else. And if I can get out, you know, when I get out west, if there's teams out there to do the restorations, yeah, I'd like to be able to jump in there and help out there.
You know, the knowledge that you'll learn with working with me, you're going to be able to take out there. But understand, they have different kind of land, they have different kind of climate, and they have different kind of materials, plus they have different kind of laws. So you basically will know how to do the work. You just got to adapt to what their situation is there. And I think you'll be fine.
Exactly.
I mean, I'd love to see you go all the way, you know. Like I told you, I'd love to see you take the restoration, you know, class here with the state. And hopefully when you get out there, they've also got something maybe they can help you get out there and find where you can take the classes with them. Like I say, here they're not that much. You know, they're only $20, $25. You just got to travel wherever they're going to have them.
Right.
You know, but you learn a lot. And to me, I feel like you learn the proper way. And that's how our state wants us to restore these cemeteries, because it's the best way to preserve them. And that's my teaching, you know.
Now, on your website, walkamongthedeadgirl.com, it says that you've traveled to 1,329 cemeteries.
Yeah.
Is that still the right number, or
I'm probably a couple. It's gone up a little bit. This summer, it'll probably go up another 200. I normally hit about 200 cemeteries a summer. And, you know,
wow.
I'm not going and photographing. You know, the state and some restorators get on my website to look at the condition of the cemetery before they go there. Or if somebody calls, you know, John Hyder, especially, who's a restorator, a very well-known one in my area, somebody will call him about a cemetery, and the first thing he does, he says, he goes to my website to see if I've been there yet, so he can talk to them on the phone to see what the condition of the cemetery is in. You know, because I go from everything to huge, fixed cemeteries to these little, tiny wooden ones that I've walked for hours to get to or with a landowner. That just don't look like it exists anymore. So, you know, when I go to these cemeteries, I'm not photographing every certain single stone. I do photograph the really neat ones, or especially if they've got history or a story that I see. Basically the front entrance of what it looks like to go in, and then I walk it, and I give you an idea of what it looks like if you were going to walk that cemetery. You know, and then I make sure the latitudes and longitudes are right. So if somebody wants to visit, you just grab that, put it in, it'll take you right there. And a lot of times I'll tell you if it's private or not. Now, Illinois has a new bill they're trying to pass that just came out, and I don't know if it's passed yet. I need to look. That landowners must let genealogists and family members, anybody doing history, cross their land to get to a cemetery. So that is a good law for us to come out for us who are actually doing work there. But you have to work with the landowners. I always do, because when you do, they help you. A lot of them have tractors. A lot of them come out and they'll help you. They'll help cut it. And there has to be a maintenance program after you fix that cemetery. So you want them to help you so they can keep that cemetery mowed and taken care of and let you know if anything has fell down in it once you have fixed it. So working with landowners is a big must to get along with in the cemetery board. I've made more friends who, you know, have land with their cemeteries on it because I work with them. I let them know what their rights are, and that they can, here's the phone number, call the state, and they'll tell you. They'll give you what you need. And don't ever let anybody come to your cemetery and say, I want to restore it, unless they can show you proof, and if they've taken the class, and they have to give you, it's like making the application, you know. Show me what you can do before I let you come do this work. And I pretty much just let them know, you know, the best advice I can give to anybody is never move a stone. I think that's the number one rule for anybody, no matter what state you are, because once you move it and there's no paperwork, you have just lost that person's identity.
Okay, you're pretty much screwed. Yeah.
So unless you've got photos or family members who say it goes right here.
Oh, yeah. Someone does actually know that. But with a lot of the older stones, yeah, it's tough. What's the nicest, the most interesting cemetery you've been to? just for visit.
I've been to some out of state. I love I love Cleveland, Ohio. I actually took my daughter there and went with some friends. I'll make sure I say this right. The hearse angel. I may not have said that right. Is one of the most photographed angels in the United States. And it's a male, and his wings are spread real big. That whole cemetery is amazing. You'd have to take several days just to walk it. And, you know, Chicago cemeteries are beautiful, too, and so are St. Louis. I love the big cemeteries because, like I say, I'm a photographer. I love to go through. I love to see the interesting things. But like I say, you know, like the Slavo Orthodox where the king is buried, Boone Cemetery on the Petroglyph, you know, the Native Americans, you know, when you start going down there where the Cherokees are buried, it's that history, you know, the Abraham Lincoln thing. It's just amazing. Those kind of things, I think, really, once I go back and do the research, they're more my favorite than anything because it's just the history and just finding out what it is and knowing that it's there is kind of like a little treasure, you know. And a lot of them I go back more than once just because I like to be there.
Yeah. I know that feeling.
So, you know, yeah. We solved the crime. Joe Dyer and I did. Joe's on our team, and we're working on a book together, a historical book in the county we live in. But there was a stone in a city building back in the day, probably 20 years ago. The police officer found it. Somebody had taken it out of the cemetery, put it on the stairs at the school, at the high school. Cops found it, looked for the location, could never find it. So it sat in this building for over 20-some years. Somebody gave him a tip that it was in there. He was on the city board. He went in. He found it. He found the location of the stone, and this summer we contacted the family that doesn't even live in the state, and we were able to put the stone back in the cemetery where it belonged. I had to extend the base because it was broke, but we found the exact location, and we solved the crime. And it felt good. I mean, it really did. And Joe did a great job on finding out the family, and the family's coming here now. They want to see it. So, you know, that's just another thing that we do. You know, you start doing a little bit here and there, and then it just grows. And my whole thing is I volunteer all my time when it comes to cemetery. I work a full-time job. I've been a screen printer for 20 years. I print T-shirts. And I love my cemetery work. If I got paid for it, I would do it 24/7. But I love it, and I volunteer all my time, and I help other people, and I don't expect anything in return. I think my return is just the happiness of being alive and, you know, taking care of my soul and just enjoying it and seeing other people happy.
Well, if we're running out of time here, we have a little over 2 minutes. Well, no, 2 minutes now. If anybody wants to get a hold of you, what's the easiest way to get a hold of you?
I'm on Facebook. It's Illinois Cemeteries, Angie Johnson. You can get a hold of me at walkingamongthedeadgirl@gmail.com, or you can go to my website, walkingamongthedeadgirl.com. Sorry, my email is walkingamongthedead@gmail.com. And I also am the host to the Illinois chapter associated with Graceful Study page, and also to the Good Samaritan's Restoration page on Facebook.
Very cool. Very cool. Okay, well, Angie, thank you very much for being on tonight. No doubt you'll probably be on again. Thank you very much, and I hope you have a great evening.
Me too. Thanks a lot, Jim. Thanks for having me.
All right, have a good one.
Have a good night.
Okay, I have like 60 seconds to talk about my next guest for next week. Next week's guest is Andrea Perrone. If you've seen the movie The Conjuring, well, this is one of the girls who lived it. She's the author of House of Darkness, House of Light, Volume 1 and Volume 2. Volume 3 is coming soon. So tune in next week for Andrea Perrone from The Conjuring. I want to wish you all a good evening. Love you all. God bless you. And see you next Tuesday. Hope you all have a good one.
Thank you, dear.